Let's start with the first question, which is, what is Modbap?
Modbap is modular boombap. So basically, hip hop production infused with modular synthesis and general synthesis. You know, that's it at its core. As simple as it is, you make hip hop music, boombap. But I've even seen people doing trap music and start incorporating modular synthesis and stuff. And to me, that's Modbap, because you're incorporating hip hop production style into or incorporating modular synthesis and deep synthesis and stuff like that into your hip hop production style.
Right. So it doesn't really matter about what you're actually using, as long as it's a modular instrument with hip hop.
Mm-hmm. Yep. And I think there's something to be said for, like, for instance, I almost feel like, for me, it's more of, you know, when I first started doing modular, I was at like a happy hour with somebody from a synth company. I won't mention a synth company, but you know, this cat has become a pretty good friend. So we were like, and we realized we lived in the same neighborhood. So we finally caught up with each other and we went to like happy hour. So we're having some grub and some drinks. And I was just getting into modular. And so he was saying, yo, I can't wait till you get to a point where you start thinking modular. And at that point, I didn't really realize, I'm like, thinking modular, bro. What are we even talking about?
I don't even know what that means right now.
Yeah, well, it didn't dawn on me. But you know, the thing is, you think modular. Like, so I think what the key is not necessarily, it's almost, it feels a little esoteric in the sense of, like, for instance, if you, I have the Hydra synth sitting
right
here.
Yeah.
And I can send an LFO out of the Hydra synth or a gate out of the Hydra synth to control something on my modular or to do something that affects the sound that I'm working on. Or I have envelopes, LFOs, and filters and stuff in my modular set that I can send stuff from my, say, MPC or the Force. Or, you know, you constantly think about how to modulate stuff, how to process stuff.
Right, okay.
How to not just modulating and processing, but the signal flow and where you want the signal to go and how you want it to interact with the beat, how you want it to be synced. And you start thinking about clocks and you start thinking about logic and you start thinking about modulation and all that stuff. That's thinking modular in my mind.
Yeah, I got it. Yeah. Because everything has to have a path. Mm-hmm. You know, whether you know where that path leads or not, you're kind of going somewhere all the time. I get it. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that makes perfect sense. It's just, I think it just happens, you know?
Mm-hmm. It does. Once you start using modular synthesis, you start to think about, even if you don't think of it with the actual words of thinking of a path or thinking of a signal flow or any of that stuff, you really start thinking of in a little bit different way. And that's what I think is the dope thing about blending it with hip hop production, because there's some staple sort of techniques in hip hop production. And we all sort of know them, even if we don't think about the names of them. You know what I mean? Like, one of the things I remember when I was studying for my degree, and all the stuff I learned, I already knew.
Gotcha.
It's just, I didn't know the name of it. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. It's like, okay. That's what that's called. I've been doing that. Okay. Right. So it's that same kind of thing when it comes to hip hop production. We all sort of have this foundational approach. When you hear it, you know it. And when you're doing it, you know, sort of innately what you're doing. Mm-hmm. The really astute cats know, yo, I'm actually chopping this, or I'm actually, you know, adding the LFO to the, you know what I'm saying, to the filter. I'm modulating the filter. I'm adding a little more envelope. The really astute cats know that kind of stuff. But I think at the foundation, we all kind of know what we're doing with hip hop when we do it well.
Yeah.
And then when you start adding the idea of modular synthesis or synthesis in general, you start to think a little bit differently, which innately pushes the envelope in your hip hop production. And that's where you start entering that realm of Modbap.
Yeah. I think we've gotten to a point with hip hop where we're getting into that rigid stage where it's becoming almost classical in this form. Like, mm-hmm. when we're speaking about, you know, rules and methods, and those are kind of set, you know, yeah. I almost find like I have to, it's almost like, heresy to say, okay, well, stop chopping or try something else, because people will push back and be like, no, that's the foundation. I'm like, it ain't, that's, there is no foundation. Like, right, you're supposed to, you're supposed to keep on moving. You know, that's a tool. That's something you can
creative.
Use.
Creative. Yeah. You're supposed to keep on being creative. And that's the gumbo of hip hop.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like, how do you think we got to this point? That's, the chopping stuff came from a need to create and be outside of what we had the ability to do before.
Exactly. And we're at a point where we've gotten, we're like, that's it. It's set. This is hip hop. And you just keep growing that. Mm-hmm. But what modular does is it kind of, it doesn't erase all that, but it makes you have to think about other things. Mm-hmm. So I think it's like a big reset button, you know?
Yeah. And I think to, you know, it's kind of like exercising the old brain in a little bit different way. Mm-hmm. And it forces you to, you know, and it could be some science behind the whole, the idea of mapping new pathways, because you're exciting parts of your thought process and your brain to think a different way.
Yeah.
Now you're starting to think a way, and that those pathways start to open up. You're firing neurons that you hadn't fired before.
Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Yeah.
And it opens you up in a different way creatively, I think.
Yeah, I think that's definitely it. Like, you have to think differently when you're dealing with a different instrument, like any modular instrument. And even to do the same thing, let's say you wanted to just do a straight ahead boom bap classic, like chop it up, drop a, you know, do that. You can't do that the same way you would in an MPC.
Right.
So
right.
You have it's to think, true. Yeah. So it's a whole new
it's
method.
It's very true.
Yeah, I love that idea about the whole concept of integrating modular. Now, here's a question for you. Mm-hmm. What constitutes Modbap? So does semi-modular count? Does something like a Moog Mother 32 or Grandmother by Moog count as a modular instrument?
Yeah, so I've thought about this a lot. And I think so when it comes down to, there was a point when I was like, well, yeah, semi-modular counts, obviously, because you could patch things, right? And that's where I started thinking, mm-hmm. Okay, cool. But then when you go to places like, you go to the computer, there's your rack modular stuff on computer now, right? So you have, and there's always been, you know, I think the Modular V by Arturia. Mm-hmm. So you can do some patching that way. There's, what is it, Native Instruments Blocks. Then you have VCV rack. So I don't, for me, I think it's the difference between, that's all modular, firstly. Mm-hmm. But for me, it's the difference between, and the way I rationalize it for myself, you have somebody using Fruity Loops. Think, I'm drawing a blank, crap. That's what happens when you get old.
Tell me about it.
Think, my man FL Studio Fruity Loops, little brother.
Yeah, yeah. Don't make me do the same as you, man.
This is ridiculous.
Oh, my goodness. Ninth Wonder.
Ninth Wonder. All right. Yeah, so pardon me. Yeah, Ninth Wonder, of course. So you have something like Fruity Loops and that kind of stuff. And now Ninth Wonder has graduated to, you know, MPCs, machines, or whatever. I've seen them use a 2500. I've mm-hmm. seen them use chain and all that. So to me, it's kind of like the difference between, you know, you had some people that were thinking that you ain't making hip hop if you're not on an MPC or SP1200 or something. But mm-hmm. then you had Ninth Wonder pop up and make us aware that people are making dope stuff just as dope in that same genre on Fruity Loops, right? Mm-hmm. It's because they use the same techniques on a different device, and his skills obviously translated from FL Studio to other things eventually, right? He eventually grew. So that kind of comparison made me think about it with, like, you know, yeah, semi-modular is still modular because you're patching, and it makes you're thinking in a modular sense. You're thinking about the signal flow. You have to understand what all those sort of terms mean when you go, and right now I'm looking at the Mother 32, right? So that's in my rack. Mm-hmm. If somebody goes and messes with the pulse width, you know what I'm saying, or the cutoff or the frequency, and then you say you patch something from one thing to another on that the semi-modular synth. Well, you, even if you don't know what you're patching, mm-hmm. you start to recognize it's kind of like, ooh, I touched the fire. That's hot. Now I know. Okay. I don't know if that's called fire, but I know I don't like the way it feels.
Yeah, so I'm not
Right. So it's like, if you don't know what pulse width is and you twist the pulse width knob, you'll see what it does. Now you kind of understand, does that work for your sound? Doesn't work for your sound. And then you're patching something you don't maybe like what that is, or do like what it is. You keep patching it. Like that modular thought process is going to happen whether you're using semi-modular, straight up modular, Eurorack, the 5U is going to happen whether you're using VCV rack, because you have to think about the signal flow and the path and all of that stuff. You know what I mean? So yeah, I do consider those things modular. And somebody asked me, so, hey, am I doing Modbap if I'm using, say, VCV rack and MPC? Yeah. I mean, if you're still making hip hop when you're doing that. Yeah.
That's perfect. Like you said, two major things that really brought up some thoughts to me, which was one, to summarize it all, it's really about the patching and the aspect of, like we went back to earlier, thinking modular, like something, your patch has to go somewhere until it reaches its destination. On an MPC, your sample just has to go on a pad and that's kind of it. You could choose to do something else, but in modular, to even get the sound somewhere, you have to start before. You know what I mean? So it's it sounds like as long as you're patching, it seems to be the core of it. Because I used to think it was like, to me, I'm like, well, Modbap is CV. As long as CV is involved, like that's where the magic is at. But now what I'm realizing from what you're saying is CV adds to the flavor a whole lot because that's just something that's new again. But the idea of patching is really what ends up getting you where you're going in the first place.
Right. Yeah. And you start to think, like I'll say, when Akai sent me the MPC X and they did that because they were like, yo, you a hip hop dude, one of the few hip hop dudes we know of. Actually, they told me at that point, you're the only hip hop dude that we know of that's this deep into modular. And it's so prominently advocating for MPC or known for using the MPC. So we want you to be able to test the CV and this kind of stuff and this kind of thing. The thing about it, what I was faced with at that point is, oh, so I've always wanted this. I've always wanted these this feature set. Then I had to, when I was sitting, open this thing up. Now, what do I do? Well, how do I make these two talk? So the first thing I could think of is like, well, one, my beats are going to come from the MPC. So I'm still programming. That's the foundation of the thing. I'm still programming the way I would program beats anyway. But now I got these eight CV on the back. They're assignable. And so it could be CV or gate. And so now I can take, I would always do the eighth gate, the last gate, or the last CV, assignable CV on the MPCX. I would turn that into a gate and I would take a track and dedicate it to basically a click. So I would record a pulse.
Yeah.
Just like the metronome, right?
Yeah.
And send that out of CV as a gate, and I would throw that to Tempi. And now I'm clocking Tempi in my rack, and now I got six other gates that are all synced to my MPC, right? So that idea of thinking, how do I even integrate modular synthesis and keep it in time? Because time is so important.
Yeah.
In Modbap, you know what I mean? I mean, because in hip hop, timing is so important. It's all about those rhythms. The rhythm is king in hip hop. You go back to funk, the rhythm is king in funk. And that's kind of our grandfather right there. You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I'm struggling with that now. Like I'm always thinking about trying to get my system in time just enough so that it's not like completely random. Because it's a fine line when you can have odd meters and odd rhythms, and then you could just get into a mess real quick. You know, so I had to have some sync, some type of reference coming from something stable, you know?
Right.
And I'm struggling with the same thing. So I ended up using the SP because it has a lot of click outs.
Okay.
And, and by that, I'm triggering events within the modular system in order to keep some sort of time going on. So yeah, like the whole patching aspect and all that, it's super important.
Yeah, it's super important. And I mean, and think about what we're speaking of now. when you're dealing with, like, we just spoke both times from my reply to yours and your reply to mine. We were speaking about this idea of our traditional way of doing stuff and then integrating something that's not typical, integrating something that's non-traditional into that sort of foundation of how we make hip hop. Mm-hmm. And so those conversations, those thoughts are always going to come up for people that are starting to do this. How do I approach this? How do I keep this stuff in time so it sounds good? And so then you start thinking of, you know, I talk to D Still a lot, and him being a drummer, we talk about ghost notes and space between the rhythm and different timings and stuff. And I always admire folks that have a good handle on using different time signatures and stuff like that. Yeah. But the beauty of it is, well, the thing about hip hop is this 4/4. You know what I mean? It's what it is. But when you start getting into modular, I think I even got a better understanding of time divisions and you know, just different rhythm signatures and time signatures and different stuff like that, and how clock divisions, clock multiplying, those kinds of things. You start thinking like that, you're over in there at that point.
Yeah.
You're incorporating that. Like, you're all of a sudden doing something that's next. And that's what I mean about with Modbap. It has the power to be able to push the envelope.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And how you think and how you create.
I think it's of like a super creative tool. Like, it's just, I got my system and I didn't really dig into it too quick. And then when I started, like, yeah, I immediately just started, like you're saying, trying to find out ways to get to integrate. But now I find I'm so creatively overwhelmed that I actually have to write stuff down. I'm like, okay, try this, try that, and try that. Like, I'm starting to get, like, in my sleep, like, oh yeah, this, you know, and I'll, start to like think of ideas.
It becomes obsessive.
Yeah. And now, like, you know what? Remember to try this when you get up, because this is going to solve a problem that you've been thinking about when you were awake, you know? And my question is that, do you think, like, it's almost like it doesn't matter what you get and how much research you do, it's still another whole new journey once you begin to actually patch. So do you think that you can fake your way through it and then learn what's going on after?
Certainly. I really think so. I mean, because the thing is, it's one of those things that I think the folks that have a little bit of elitism about them in modular, they're the guys that may have more experience. And so, you know, it's an intellect thing.
Yeah.
But the fact of the matter is, and I think there's also sometimes a little pressure when you use modular synthesis, if you're part of the community, there's sometimes a little pressure to feel like you need to know everything right off the bat.
Yeah.
You know, but you're literally talking about hundreds, perhaps thousands of different modules that are out there, maybe thousands at this point. The idea is nobody can know everything. And then too, if you mess around and read a book, okay, so listen, you could mess with modular for a year and know your tools. And that could be, maybe you don't read manuals, right? You mess with your modular for a year and not really know everything about your modules. Then you read the manual, you're like, yo, I can do that too. You kind of open your brain about how you could patch something that you've probably been using all the time. Yeah. And the all of the tools and techniques are so deep. There's so much to it. Like, it's a journey. And I think that's one of the things that people have to realize. It is a journey, and it's okay not to know everything right off the bat. I don't think anybody does. Yes. But if you know enough to start integrating and get on that ramp, you know, I think that's what's really cool at. Like, because it's, you know, like, for instance, 3 or 4 years in, and then all of a sudden I started using Logic modules, and it blew my mind. Yeah. I'm like, oh, Logic module. Like, okay, now I have a module that's doing the thinking for me. And then that's how you can get into generative patching and stuff like that. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And like this, it's a journey. It's always going to be a thing where you learn. But once you, at first, you can latch on to a couple things and be able to make something dope. or you could latch on to a couple things and know that you're making some dope sounds and maybe sample those sounds.
Yeah.
And I don't know if you would necessarily call it fake it till you make it, but at the same time, you're rocking modular. Maybe you are the type that could go patch live. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. But in your production, you're rocking modular. It may be making some sounds and sampling it and chopping it. But to me, that's that idea of Modbap, where you're starting to get into this other realm and bring it back home into where your comfort zone is too. Because it works both ways. After a while, you'll stretch your imagination and kind of push the envelope a little bit. Then you start to get outside of your comfort zone.
Yes.
And start going in that direction. You know what I mean?
Yeah. I think there's like two different stages you have to have concurrently. Like one is the like, I'm just trying something. I don't know where I'm going, but I'm just going to patch. And that's where I think like it's possible to fake it. I think that's the thing. Like I think there's a lot of fear in the idea that you're supposed to know what you're doing. And you're right. Like there's no way you're going to know, because just a simple amount of modules that are coming out yearly is staggering. So forget, like, you're never going to know, because these modules are getting just, they're just getting too good right now. Like they're amazing, you know?
They are.
So you have to keep on wandering and trying. But at the same time, once you have done something, I think it's good to go back and understand, well, how did I end up here? Like, how is this crazy patch that I did? Because I know once I turn everything off and unplug everything, I'm never going to get it back. So let me understand why this is happening so I can add that to my toolbox, and it will get me to the same position that I was before. But now I can wander again knowing that I built that foundation, you know?
Right.
Yeah. So it's like, you got to keep on trying and understanding at the same time.
Yep. That's it. And I've experienced it before where, you know, once you get into a groove and start patching, you never know. Sometimes you may have some idea. Mm-hmm. I mean, it can be as simple as, and I keep going back to LFO because it's like such a simple way, or even a filter. You know, I know that I'm going to plug this sound into the filter, and if I turn the frequency cutoff, it's going to filter the sound and, you know what I'm saying, shape the sound a bit from a frequency perspective. Mm-hmm. You know that. That's a simple thing to know. But once you start throwing different modulations at it, or when if you start using some sort of clock divider and these kinds of things, I don't know, even if you start using random and those different things, there's a million different things you can start to do that maybe you won't know right off the bat. I always trip on something like maths, because everybody is like, if you don't have maths, you're not even modular. But that's just crazy. I think that's from a time period in modular. But you know, there's a lot of people I know that have modular that don't have maths. Yeah. But when I look at maths, I'm like, it does a lot of stuff. Yeah. And when you look at it, it don't tell you that it does all of that stuff.
No. And the thing is, you can make maths with the modules that you have if you really, I mean, math just, it's almost like a consolidation of a lot of things that you would have to buy. But if you have a rig, you could pretty much get like,
you can get the rise and fall and the function generator type of envelope type stuff out of it. Contour sort of circuit. But yeah, and that's the thing. If you look at it, you're not going to really know that right off the bat. But then if you start to patch it and twist the knobs a little bit, you may start to understand the relation of what it's doing to the sound.
Yeah.
And then you know, like, oh, I want to leave that one here. Now let's go to this knob. I want to kind of twist that. You start to get to a place where you have to get to a place. Well, I don't know if you have to, but I think eventually it's one of those places that it's part of that journey. You get there where you start to be like, how'd I do this? Oh, I'm starting to understand how I got there. Because I think that's one of those milestones. And everybody I know that does modular tends to have that moment where they're like, yo, I feel confident that I know what to do when I sit down. Mm-hmm. Or I feel confident that I know how to get to what's in my head. You know what I mean? And that's pure repetition and learning the tools, you know?
And you want to recreate to some extent what you did. Like, I get patches are unrecallable for the most part, but you kind of want to do it again. Like, for me, what I'm experiencing is just these little minute movements. Like, I'll have something going on that I like, and I'll just touch something, like literally touch it, like a nudge, and the whole patch changes. And I'm like, no. You got to understand what, why did that happen?
That's right.
Because
right.
I don't know what happened at the moment, but I'm like, I got to go back and understand why is it like that in order for me to get even in the same ballpark than mm-hmm. I was before, because if I don't, it's just going to seem like some sort of weird kind of stuff that's happening that I'm not in control of, or I don't even understand, you know?
Right.
I think that's crazy.
That's a good point too, man. I mean, and I've had some incidents. You know, I've been doing Modbap for a good long time now, but last year was the first time that I started performing out live mm-hmm. with it. And so there was a point where it didn't make much sense to have, well, I don't want to say it didn't make much sense. There was a point I had no need to save anything, like say in the things that will allow you to save a preset.
Yeah.
So for instance, there's Zadar. You could save, Zadar is a quad envelope, basically. And it has a digital screen and you can save your presets. Mm-hmm. And so I can go in and be like, yo, for the show, I need to make sure I load preset 2. But then something like Fluxus 1, which is my sequencer in my live rig. And I know that, you know, I have, it's a 4-track sequencer, right? Mm-hmm. So you obviously could have your melodies programmed in there and you'll be like, yo, I want to save the state. So I'll save this as a preset number 2, whatever. I may never go back to that stuff, but you know, I experienced it live where it was so important that I'd gotten familiar enough with my module, mm-hmm. with my modules in my Eurorack case, that I was able to get back to a place where I was in the middle of a show when my modular rig became unplugged.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So like, that's when I started realizing, like, yo, all those moments when I'm kind of mentally taking notes or even actually taking notes, you know what I mean? And kind of coming in and saying like, let me go back to this thing, or let me patch this up the similar way. It helped out that, you know, I opened up my show with sort of an ambient, I don't know if you've seen any of the live streams.
Oh, yeah, all of them, yeah.
Yeah, so typically I open up with some sort of, and I don't necessarily want to call it ambient, but it's kind of ambient-esque. Mm-hmm. Typically I open up the show with that, and it's, you know, something off the Eurorack, and I kind of build it up to a point until I drop the beat. And then once I drop the beat, I'm off to the races. We into, you know, Modbap, heavy beats, and lots of synth stuff, and, you know, performance effects and stuff. But just when I, you know, I did this whole ambient thing, and just when I got to the point where I dropped the beat, it's like the beat dropped 8 bars in, the Eurorack came unplugged.
Oh, man.
Yeah. And so now the beat is just rocking. So I'm messing with the performance effects and kind of keeping something, some excitement about it going, while in the meantime, I'm plugging my rack back up. And then I'm going on to Fluxus 1 sequencer, and I'm going to preset number 3 because that's what I was operating off of. So I get to preset number 3, then I have to go back to Zadar, my quad envelope, and I have to go to preset number 3 there as well. But once I dialed it in, because the sequence was playing and I was firing CV off of the force while the beat was rocking, it's like once I dialed those two things back in, I was back full-fledged.
Yeah.
Within 1 minute. I have the video and I look back at it. I was like, minute 7, this happened. And by minute 8, 10, I was up again.
I've watched all your performances that are online. I didn't notice. So, you know what I mean?
Yeah, I could tell you the one. And if you go back and watch it, like, say, 6 to 8 minutes, you'll notice.
Yeah. But that's the idea of, performing with it. And that is where it comes in handy, mm-hmm. presets and everything like that, especially if you're doing, like, you're doing a lot in your performances because it's not just strict modular. You have outside equipment. I think that's where things can get really, like, it's a lot to manage. And it's good. It never feels wrong. But mm-hmm. it's like, you know, these type of things can happen as they do in any live performance. But, you know, the recovery is a little bit more difficult if you have no idea. Because when you're performing, things are kind of like, if you're at home, you'd be like, oh, yeah, the power's on, you know, let me unplug it. But if you're the type to kind of freak out on stage, things mm-hmm. start looking confusing. Like you're looking at it like, I know I patched this. I don't know what this is anymore. Like, I don't know. Did I patch this? You know,
because the idea of having to troubleshoot something and you're in the middle of everybody watching, you know what I mean? It's not a easy task.
Yeah.
So that's the stuff where I think the modules that can save presets or can save states, that's where the magic is right there. That's the beauty in them. But then you realize that's only a portion of it. There's all this other stuff. What I'm always afraid of is, and I don't know if it's afraid, but like, I'm just always like, yo, people like to look at your rig when you're performing, but not while you're performing, right? Like
before
set up,
yeah.
And then people like to go over and check it out. I'm always leery, like, yo, don't touch nothing. Like, I don't know what you'll mess around and touch.
Yeah. I don't like nobody near what I'm doing at all.
Exactly.
Like, do not come here. Don't give me the, hey, what you got going on here? No, nothing.
Yeah, move.
Just stay away. I'll talk to you when it's over.
That's it. That's it. So, yeah, there's definitely that. But that's part of that learning process and kind of learning what your rig does. I think one thing that I learned from Shiro, my brother Shiro, is that he don't change his rig. And so he knows that it's an extension of his, it's like another appendage. You know what I'm saying? He knows that rig inside and out.
Yeah.
And I think there's something really important about that, because I feel like there's nothing he can't overcome at any given moment because he knows those tools inside and out. The rest of us, I'll say the rest of us, because anybody else in the crew or that performs live, I think people more commonly swap things in and out. Right. So I think I've learned from him, like, at least keep your the foundation of your rig sort of stable. And I think if I hadn't done that, I wouldn't been able to recover on the spot that way.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, 'cause I knew the tools that were in my box and I knew what was going to fire up and what was not going to fire up. I had a four channel mixer there and I turned down the things that I knew was going to come on crazy until I got, you know, those patches back where they needed to be. Right. So, yeah, there's something real special about kind of knowing your stuff. And but then there's also something that's really dope about adding that element of uncertainty in there. And that even goes back to when you were talking about how to integrate certain things or how to keep some semblance of rhythm and timing, but also have some randomness. And I think there's something magical about that.
Yeah.
Allowing the system to breathe a little bit, but still keeping it in time, which time is so important in hip hop. You got to be able to keep stuff in time. But I think what I've always thought to be special about doing Modbap is that randomness and that sort of the machine is alive sort of vibe, you know, but still being able to wrangle it in. I've literally referred to it as wrangling frequencies.
Yeah, man. I always think of it like going to like concerts back in the days, like you would go and you knew something was going to pop off. Mm-hmm. You just didn't know when, you know what I mean? And it's like, I got so good with concerts here that, you know, there was a time when I'd just be like, okay, it's time to get closer to the door. Like clockwork. You know, you just see the scuffling, you see the running. I'm like, I'm right by the door. I'm out, you know?
I'm out.
You
I'm
know?
Already.
And that's the way modular is to me. It's like, you know, something, you're waiting for a jewel to pop off. It's just all positive with modular, but you know something good's going to happen. It's just a matter of when and how, you know, and what it's going to sound like. But I think, yeah, leaving room for that because it's so easy. It's like it almost never sounds, it sounds good more than it sounds bad, you know, especially once you get to control it. So it's always something that I look forward to and something that I try to instigate a lot of the times with modular.
Yeah, certainly. And you know, there's been times I've practiced for shows and I get there and something like you said, something happens with while I'm tweaking something on my rig and the modular, something happens and I'm like, oh, that was cool. You know what I'm saying? I can dial it in a little more, dial it back a little more. And there's even been times when people ask me afterwards, like, yo, how'd you do XYZ? I was hearing this real trippy sort of, and I'll be like, what? I didn't know that happened. You know what I'm saying? And then once I talk about it a little more, I'm like, oh, yeah. That was a Q-pass or whatever it might be. You know what I mean? I was modulating, you know, and giving the move, giving some movement to the, you know, that kind of stuff comes up. But some of it's not planned. And I think that's the beauty of Eurorack.
It's an amazing, like, I just, you know, for me in hip hop, I don't even call it love hate in this point. It's almost like I've literally grown out of it. because it's been with me for, I mean, we kind of were born into this type of thing. I don't remember a time when I didn't hear rapping. You know what I mean?
that's real.
You know, like, even, and, you know, you watch it change in so many forms that it's like, okay, like, if I don't listen to it anymore, it doesn't mean much, you know, because it's not like all that history is going to jump out of you. So seeing modular come back in this form with a new set of avenues to take is crazy. And one of the things that I really like that you brought to my attention is the idea of sampling the modular, because that kind of, that's the first thing you would think, well, that's against the rules. You can't sample, you know, the whole thing is you have to main authentic to going strictly modular. But what you're explaining is it's not that. Like, whatever you're using, whatever you're patching, you could do whatever you want with it. So I've been creating things with modular as an influence and then sampling that. And there's no way I could ever, like, you know what I mean? You just can't create that stuff without the modular.
Yeah, exactly.
So it's a whole new set.
You so the thing is, it's kind of like, you start to, like, for me, it was a matter of creating these sound beds or these ideas and having this thing happening on the modular rig, enjoying what it is, but then wanting to take it, I don't know, like, just kind of take it and do the traditional stuff to it and then see where that takes me. You know what I'm saying? So, like, that's why a few years back, my man Emcee was at my studio, and it was kind of like an impromptu visit. He was like, "Yo, I'm in town, and we got some veggie burgers." And then we came back to my studio, back to the crib, and went in the studio. And so, as we were talking, I was telling him, like, "Yo, everything is vinyl, like." It doesn't matter. Like, yeah, you see all this synth stuff around here, but it's all vinyl to me. Like, okay, I know how to use majority of the stuff and I stumble on other things or whatever I might make. But once I make something, to me, I'm right back in that vinyl state of mind where that sound is about to get sampled and chopped and replayed. Like, to me, that it becomes, that's the hip hop in me.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And that's what's dope about it. You can get to a point where you're pretty good at modular. Maybe you ain't really good, but if you stumble on something that you dig and now you want to take it back to a familiar place. And for instance, I'm working on this joint called King Rising. And it's really about kind of guerrilla beat making.
Yeah.
And what I mean by that is kind of, you know how they say guerrilla filmmaking?
Yeah.
And that's where things are sort of imperfect. And sort of there's no permits and there's no all the stuff that you're typically supposed to do for filmmaking. You may not have that stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So the way I'm looking at this King Rising project, it's almost guerrilla beat making where I'm not about to worry about getting deep into mixing it. I'm not about to worry about holding myself up, thinking of all of the stuff to make it perfect. I'm more about the vibe on this thing. And I'm more about, you know, one, you know, performing the composition, the Modbap composition in one take and see where that takes me. But performing it like I'm performing it live, right?
Yeah,
like
with
performance effects and drops and, you know, whatever it might be. And doing that in one take, going section A's and B's on, and you know, doing the live arrangement. And that me, and I'm not going to worry, I'm going to master it. May not be super professional mastering, but it's going to be more raw, I guess. And so that's why I'm calling it King Rising. It's kind of guerrilla beat making and Modbap beat tape. You know what I'm saying?
Nice.
You know, so the idea is, the reason I brought that up is because I was letting my man Upright Bryce take a listen to what I have so far. And he was like, "Yo, are you sampling your modular synth like parts in here?" And I'm like, yeah. He's like, "Yeah, I was wondering if you were doing that because it sounds so organic, but then I hear chops." You know what I'm saying? Like you hear where something may not be a perfect loop because it's chopped and it's cutting off the last piece of the chop. You know what I mean? The way it happens when you sample stuff. And I was like, yeah, you hear that. It's like a combination of, I may have the modular actually doing some stuff live, but then I may have sampled a different part of the of a modular sort of expression or melody or something, and then chop that up and throw that over the beat like we did when we just had an MPC.
Yeah.
And so there's something that to me is kind of like the epitome of Modbap. Being able to draw, and I may say that a few other times from time to time, anytime we get to talk, but I think there's this place, if you look at hip hop production mm-hmm. and Eurorack stuff, anything that has to do with Eurorack and modular, not just Eurorack, but modular synthesis, if you look at those as two buckets, you have techniques in both of them.
Yeah.
And so the thing about Modbap is kind of pour them in one, combining those buckets. And there's no reason why you can't dig into your hip hop bag and your techniques. There's no reason why you can't then in turn go back and dig into your modular synthesis bag,
yeah.
into those techniques and combining them all.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Why I bring it up and why I think it's completely genius is because exactly what you just said, it doesn't leave anything out. What I found is that I started out as a DJ and yeah. I abandoned DJing for production. I scratch every now and then, but mm-hmm. this is coming from somebody who used to DJ every single hour of the day when I had a minute. Right. And I traded that in. But with modular, I don't have to do that. What I naturally find myself doing is exactly what you've explained. I end up trying to incorporate. I try to bring yes. it in. And I've even brought turntables back in now.
Dope.
More because of modular in the way I think now than production ever did. So it maintains the link. If I can use a sampler that's 30 years old and incorporate that in 2020 into something that I'm doing with modular equipment, it maintains the legacy of boombap.
Yes.
You know what I mean? And I don't have to feel like this is the old, that's the new. There is no old new. You know, it's all the same
thing.
Yeah,
it's all together.
Yeah. I think that's genius.
I think that's the beauty of it, man. Like having it all together. And I'll tell you, I think this is what kind of pushed me into this space that is Modbap. And when I thought of the word Modbap and realized that I'm doing something here, mm-hmm. gave it a name, right? And then looked at my man Shiro and realized later, like, hey, he's doing something too. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? You know, but the idea of I had this maybe a bit of an inner struggle. I don't know if it's a struggle, but there's just a little bit of a light turmoil mm-hmm. Where the stay real and be authentic sort of vibe was like, yo, we're supposed to be doing this if you're doing hip hop. You start doing too much other stuff, you're not doing hip hop. But I was like, okay, but when I go back and listen to the godfathers and the forefathers of hip hop, they were digging in all kinds of bags, yo.
Yeah.
Like they just were. But I think there's something about being able to incorporate that stuff and be comfortable. So I had to teach myself and be around people who were really good at flipping samples and making boom bap beats. And I'd been around people for years, but when I started producing, I had to kind of be, because what came more naturally for me was playing synth parts and building that around beats and mm-hmm. stuff like that. But it obviously sounds different than, you know, chopping samples and throwing raw drum breaks and one shots and stuff, putting that together like traditional sort of boom bap hip hop, mm-hmm. right? But so I had to really work and focus and get there. Then when I got there, I was there for a good while and doing that stuff pretty well, to a point where one of my homeboys, who, you know, was one of my best friends, and also I learned a lot of stuff from him on the production side, he was like, yo, we'll need beats from XYZ. We got the look what you're doing. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? And so that let me know, like, okay, I'm at a level now. But what I found is, because what came natural for me is playing parts, and I found that when I would have those samples, it became an arduous task to take it to another level without hiding the sample. Sometimes I got to a point where I was incorporating sort of my synth playing in with my boom bap productions, and that was cool. It was good. But I also felt like I had to do one or the other.
Mm-hmm.
And mm-hmm. I didn't like that. You know what I'm saying? I know
exactly what you mean.
At some point, I felt like I just want to do what I want to do, but I do want it to sound authentically hip hop. So what I realized is like, oh, but that's your foundation. That ain't going nowhere. You start to incorporate other stuff and start to bring that stuff in. And then the idea of processing other stuff so that you have some of that vibe. You know what I'm saying? And that's why I look at it like it's that mind state, like everything is vinyl, yo. You could use all of your techniques that you did with vinyl. And if that stuff don't necessarily sound and have the same texture, well, then learn how to add that texture.
That is it. I think people think about immediately your mind goes to bleepity blops and like very sheer, high fidelity sounding kind of synth sounds. And that doesn't work for most genres. You know what I mean? Like when you're trying to talk about getting something dirty, like you can't have, you could, and you got to be good to do it, but to have a hard beat and some kind of like, you know, just kind of artsy fartsy trills going on, it kind of is like, yeah, that's good. Your beat's hard, but it sounds separated. So adding that texture is, it's something that's possible with modular. And it's a skill that's almost championed in Modbap because you have to complement the drums.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly. And because that's the driving force of hip hop, right? Like the drums are the driving force. And even when you've had people like, there's been people that are prolific hip hop producers that have produced stuff without drums. But still, it's almost like you feel that rhythm there. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, the pulse has to be there.
Yeah, you know, and so you have to be able to know how to get the sound there. So then you're like pulling from all these different bags, you know what I'm saying? And some people may, you know, the other thing is today, and listen, I design sample packs and I sell my sample packs and stuff. And you know, a lot of people that do, you know, all kinds of sample packs and stuff that have MIDI notes or, you know, progressions and all this different stuff. There's sounds.com, there's, you know, Splice and all these different things. You can have a lot of stuff done for you. And there's a place for that. A lot of composers are like, yo, I don't have time to sit here and sound design for half the day when I got a deadline. I get that. But for me, I think it's a good thing to have in your tool set to be able to sound design, to get your sound to a place where you want it to be. And the playing field is vast. The field is vast when you look at Eurorack or when you look at modular synthesis. And I want to keep saying modular synthesis because I know you use 5U, I use 3U. But it doesn't, it's still Modbap.
I always look at it the same,
But yeah, I just kind of think that's part of the tool set. Yeah. Being able to sound design and get things to a place. Like for instance, when I do shows, I use the SP404 and I may use the vinyl simulator on my ambient pieces just to make it sound like I'm, you know, I think about it, like you go through all this trouble to make this stuff on modular just to make it sound like you're playing a record.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? But that's part of the thing. Like I want right out the gate, you to understand that place I'm coming from.
It's part of it all. Like, the idea of just like anything. That is why I initially stopped listening to hip hop. I stopped listening like abruptly, probably around 96. I was like, I'm done. Like, I haven't, like, this is not going, like, I'm just like, okay, well, you know, this ain't for me no more. And it wasn't anything like aggressive or anything like that, but I was just like, okay, I'll tune in later, you know? But I think what was missing is anything wasn't possible. It started sounding the same intentionally.
Yeah.
And I was like, okay, well, I didn't, you know, just speaking about it now, I'm understanding why that whole idea of like, I don't know what's going to come out next month. I don't know what new artist. You remember like, I'd say like 88 to 93, I had no idea what the new round of artists were going to bring. I don't think anybody expected, you know, let's just take Wu-Tang, for example. I had no idea. I knew the Genius, you know. I knew RZA or Rakim. And I had no idea that they would have come out like that. It was such a shock that I was just like, I can't even believe, like, this doesn't even sound good to me. I was almost like, what are these guys doing? You know what I mean?
Right.
But that's the type of thing that hip-hop kind of lost. Like, right now, I know what everything's going to sound like. I don't care if it comes out 2 years from now. I know what it's going to sound like.
Yeah. Yeah, you know? That's the shame about it.
Yeah. So, but that's what made me leave. It's just like, this is not the hip-hop I know. You know, and that's kind of what I got into it for. But now on Modbap, I have no idea what you're going to come out with next. I have no idea what D-Steel is going to do. I have no idea what Shiro is going to do. I have no idea what Flux is going to do. I don't even want to talk about what Upright is going to do. Like, I'm waiting. I'm like, what are you going to do? What are you going to do? You know what I mean?
Exactly.
Because, you know, and that's what I think is amazing about the genre is that it also can maintain that because everyone's different. And there is no one set instrument or combination of modules that could ever make something homogenized. It takes a lot. It would take a lot for Modbap to get to the point where it sounds like, okay, everyone's doing the same thing.
Right.
It's hard to do.
It is. It's very hard to do. I remember sitting with Aaron from Afro Rack and talking about, so we had done a series of shows and we still to this day haven't done shows where all three of us perform together, but we'd done a series of shows where I don't even know why I wasn't performing that night, but you know, it was basically Shiro and Aaron from Afro Rack and they were doing a set together. Well, I was more emceeing, not rapping, but just crowd participation and introducing one, then introducing the other. And you know what I'm saying? And then there was a point when it was me and Shiro doing something and Aaron was on the side just taking video of it, you know. But the idea is we ended up sitting down at breakfast in the middle of the night in Hollywood somewhere. I don't even know where we were. It probably wasn't Hollywood. It was just somewhere in California, somewhere in L.A. But we were sitting down and we were talking and we were almost like, well, yo, Shiro's style of Modbap is more psychedelic because it's super melodic and it really has a psychedelic feel to it. And then it was like, well, yo, Aaron's style of Modbap is very like abstract and hard. You know what I'm saying? And almost underground feeling. You know what I'm saying? Because he goes and he plays breaks and chop them and sample them and then add all these modular synthesis sort of bits and pieces and chop them and then I don't even know what the hell he's doing in the octatrack half the time. You know what I'm saying? And then they were like, but then Corry's almost like Modbap, almost like traditional boombap Modbap. You know what I'm saying? Because so it's like that's the thing about it. It's everybody's gonna do something a little different. And there's so many tools and modular synthesis sort of allows you to have an extension of your own personality. Like your expression, it's an extension of you and your expression and your personality. Like Shiro always says, yo, I could give you my rack for a month and you'll come out doing some dope stuff, but you won't sound like me and it's my rack.
That's what I like.
I love that.
Yeah, it protects it from laziness, and it protects it from it protects you from biting somebody else. Because even if your intent is to bite, you can't copy.
Yeah,
you have to end up with something else.
Yep, it's true. It's true.
Yeah,
and you know, and that too be maybe it's because of maybe happy accidents or you know it's just tough. Like
it's hard.
You know, I remember back in the day, and I know you know as a DJ. One of the most tripped out things, and I love this part of hip hop, the idea that cats used to cover up their records and protect the sources of their records with their lives. Mm-hmm. Like I knew cats that would put blank things over the labels of their records and they'd be playing something that you hadn't heard yet. You walk over there and look at it, you like, that's a white label. I don't know what that is. If you don't know the voice or the whatever it is. And there's, you know, well, what sample was that? I can't tell you. You know, these kinds of things. You ain't even got to go through that with your rack. I could, you know, look at Shonda, for instance. I love the way Shonda patches. Mm-hmm. I shouldn't say Shonda, you know, because Trevarsi. We're all fans. I just say our government names, but Trevarsi,
yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So Shonda, Trevarsi uses Traversa uses all red cables. Ain't no way you could look at her patch and know where shit goes. You know what I'm saying? You don't know where things go.
Yeah.
Because it's all red cables. It's like, yo, but even if you knew, you probably wouldn't make the same music.
Yeah, you can't. You can't. And I think modular makes you ask the question, like, why would I even want to anyway?
Yes, exactly.
You know?
But I think, you know, because there's this curiosity about modular and this curiosity about Modbap and this interest in Modbap, I think people do want, like, there's going to be people that want to be like, I want to make this the way, you know, the way the Daydream sound does it. I want to make this the way BboyTech or Shiro Voltage Controller does it. But the fact of the matter is, I think people are still going to arrive at different places. And I think there'll be some stuff that's familiar to the stuff that we're doing, but I still think people are going to arrive at different places. And on another note, the idea of the creativity of it. So doing Modbap and thinking along the lines of signal flow and incorporating that sort of Euro rack or that sort of modular bag of tricks into your hip hop production. I'm sorry, I'm drawing a blank on his name, but there's my man that I'll repost him on the Modbap Instagram channel. I've reposted him a couple times, but he's the essence of like how you get to the point where this is Modbap and that beauty of Modbap. My man is not using the same tools that maybe the rest of us use. He may have some of the same things, but he's a pretty dope virtuoso finger drumming on the Tempest. Mm. And what's cold about what he does is he's finger drumming on the Tempest. He's designed his sounds on the Tempest, his drum sounds on the Tempest, and arranged the pads in a way where he can do really dope finger drumming and fluidly finger drum. But then he's allowing triggers from what he's playing on the Tempest to go out to the sequencing and the patching that he's done in his Euro rack. Oh. So as he's finger drumming, he's advancing the sequence in his rack so that, you know what I'm saying? He's finger drumming boom bap beats. That's on crazy. An analog drum machine.
Yeah, yeah.
And advancing the sequence of this ill melodic sort of stuff on his Euro rack. Yeah. And when you listen to it, you're like, holy crap, that's brilliant. That's the magic of Modbap, I think. That's the magic of modular synthesis and the magic of knowing that you're hip hop and that you're doing hip hop, but you can incorporate all this other stuff once you get your head around it.
Yeah. It's just so many possibilities that, okay, here's a question. What do you think, when does something become not Modbap?
I think when the drums are too soft.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? As D Stills would say, when the drums are like baby farts.
Yeah.
It becomes a problem. I think you're definitely getting into, I think that there's a sect of people that like Modbap and think that you can just do it just because you do a certain drum pattern.
Oh yeah.
Okay, you could do that drum pattern, but yo, if the drums ain't hitting and this, I don't even know what that is. You know, we could say a bunch of sort of words that describe what brings that vibe to it. But, you know, I feel like and I'm quoting different people in the crew because we talk about this kind of stuff a lot. Mm-hmm. And I love what D Still says. If you can't make dope hip hop, you probably can't make dope Modbap.
Yeah, I would say.
Yeah. Right. So like people think that if they just do the drum pattern, boom, bap. Boom, boom, bat. But if the drums are not hitting, it's just kind of, you don't have certain, if it's too rigid even, you know what I'm saying? Like if it's too locked in, if it's too on the grid, and sometimes that's fine, but I think you kind of have to have a good sense of how to make hip hop music in order to make dope Modbap music. Mm-hmm. People that are kind of just pedestrian to hip hop, there's a good chance that they won't make good Modbap. It'll maybe sound like modular beats.
Well, that's what I'm getting at, because that's right. What I think is the easiest. I think, I mean, whatever I see, just the way the industry is going, there's always kind of like a way to cheat, per se. Like, oh, well, you can't play. Well, I'll just make this thing that will play chords for you. Oh, you can't. Your synth rhythm is non-existent. Okay, I'm gonna make this thing that could just make a jump pattern for you. And I think hip-hop is kind of immune to that for the reason you've stated. Like, unless you can get... It's an undescribable world. I could call it a number thing. I could call it bounce. I could call it vibe. I could call it groove. But whatever it is, if it's not there, it ain't hip-hop.
Yeah.
And it doesn't mean not stiff. Like, you could have the stiffest beats on earth, but still have that thing there.
Yeah, so it's true.
It's, you know what I mean? So it's, I think, and that's why I always recommend people, like, if you really want to understand this whole rhythm thing, if you really want to go to the core of it, you could start with African rhythms, but study a lot of James Brown and his rhythm section.
Yes.
Because there's rhythm even when there's no rhythm. Just, you know, in the way he speaks and the way, and then if you want to go from there, go to Parliament and you'll get a lot of education there. Study Bootsy, study, you know, Glenn Goins, all these people that just like, they understand what's going on. And what really, here's what, you know what, now that it's all, it's the understanding of the one.
Yes.
And people think that was lost with boombap. But if you know how to drop that one, that's kind of where that's instant groove. You know, if you got that bomb, just boom on the one, everything else is cool.
You know how, you know where the one is, and then you know how to play around in the spaces.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, that's why I say, I almost feel like when I watched the James Brown joint, the movie, and he was saying to his band, and it was kind of funny. If you, but as a musician, you start listening to what he was saying, it almost feels like when you have an epiphany, like, oh crap, James was a genius. He was saying to his band, you got dudes with all kinds of different horns, a dude with a bass guitar, dude with a lead guitar, you got a drummer, you got all these people with, you know, on the keys and all that. And he walked up to the horn players, what instrument is that you got? And like, trombone. You're like, no. And what instrument is that you got? Talking to the bass player. As a bass player, as a bass. They like, no. And he went around the room and he's asking them, and then he finally said, no, these are drums. I want you to hit it on the one. Everybody plays and starts on the one. And that's your foundation. So I think you hit something dead on right there.
Yeah. I think we tend to think the one disappeared in hip hop. And like, the example that I like to give to everyone, if you want to understand how the one shows itself in hip hop, is if you listen to Microphone Checker by Das FX and listen to how hard that one hits. There's a cymbal, there's a kick, and everything, just every single, and it's like a 2-bar loop. Yeah. It's like a 1-bar loop, I think. And it just blows up every single time. You're like, holy smoke, this is incredible. And the way they're flowing on it is in response to that one. But I think when, like, because of the younger generation, I can't blame them. And I don't know where they're, what path they're coming from. It's like they don't get that. And it's not in them. Like, I never needed an understanding an explanation of what the one was. It was just, I was hearing it all the time. Like, you hear it in black music all the time. So when you're making the music, you just make it. Like, that's just how it comes. You don't need anyone to tell you that. But when someone tells you that, you're like, oh, that's why, you know.
That's true. So what Miles Davis said, Miles, two things Miles said that I always, like, honestly, I think there's something, I'm going to be a little tangential from what I was about to say.
Yeah.
I think there's something in studying those before us.
You have to.
Whether you think it's the cool stuff or not, like, there's something about even just morsels of knowledge that cats drop. Like Miles Davis, he would say that there's rhythm in the spaces.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? And he was teaching Herbie Hancock that kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
Or the repetition in a mistake. It's a mistake unless you do it twice. you know what I'm saying? And then I watched the movie and it was a funny line. I don't know if Miles actually said this, but it was just funny how he said, I didn't know, Miles, I didn't know you knew how to play the piano. He's like, yep. He's like, well, when'd you learn that? He's like, I just woke up black, knew how to play.
It sounds like something he would say.
It sounds like something he would say. But I think, you know, like you said, like, just growing up on certain types of music, and that stuff becomes innate. And let's not, let's, you know, let's be clear. I mean, from my perspective, funk music is the father of hip hop.
Oh, no
and
doubt.
So that's why when you say go back and study James Brown, listen to his rhythm section, go back and listen to Parliament and Funkadelic,
yeah,
and start to understand all of the stuff that, and then you could fast forward to know what Dr. Dre has been doing, to know what RZA does, and to know what, you know, the Pete Rocks and the Dillas and all of these folks have been doing. And it's all influenced, you know, Q-Tip and all of it's all like influenced by funk and that rhythm section and funky rhythm and blues and stuff. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, it's so clear.
Mm-hmm.
It's like a big, huge roadmap. Like you can't miss it. All you have to do is listen to anything just that he's done just for a little bit. And with that in mind, like, you know, listen to the one, listen to the cadence of everything and it just drops. Yeah. And by the time you get to Parliament, you know, by the time you get to groups like Cameo and all, you're like, oh my, by the time you get to Rick James,
yeah,
you know how funky cold blooded is? Exactly. You know what I mean? There's so much groove in that. And it's like, there's nothing really going. It's just like an 808.
Yeah.
I'm like, why is this hitting like that? Like, why is it just bouncing like that?
Yeah,
you know, and that's it, you know?
And that's the thing too. I think I've mentioned before too, man. I mean, about somebody like, when I think about what I found special about modular synthesis, we've heard it before, we just didn't know. You know what I mean? Like, I don't know, most people don't get to a nerd out place like we're at to want to know what all the sounds are and what they're coming from and what the technology is behind it and all that, right? But you know, one of the dopest things when Stevie Wonder showed up on Homeboy's doorstep, the dudes who made the tonto.
Mm-hmm. I did look that up once. Yeah, when we spoke, I looked it up. That's crazy.
Ain't that a crazy story? Like the idea that what we're doing is really just a progression of what cats like that started by. He went to the strange dudes that were all into synths and applied his funk and soul to it. And then it became Songs in the Key of Life and all those beautiful joints that like that became some of the greatest soul music of all time. You know what I mean? And so that's why when I look at this stuff, I'm like, the foundation has always sort of dictated this stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Funk informed hip hop. And, you know, people that made incredible soul music used all these incredible, what were new at the time, synthesizers and stuff. And we don't have to stray away from that. We don't have to even try to do what they did. But if you're not afraid of that stuff and incorporating it into what you do, it's always been here.
Yeah.
It's always been here for us to use and incorporate. Doesn't mean that you have to do anything less than hip hop if that's what you're into. Doesn't mean you have to stray away from hip hop. But it's actually cool when you start to explore this stuff and incorporate it and dig, learn techniques on that side of the game. You already got techniques on your hip hop and you're digging into both of those bags. Yo, it's an amazing place to be.
It's crazy. it's like I say, it's almost too good. Like it's too mm-hmm. much. Well, what do you think can be done to deal with the fear, the hesitance, everything to do with like, oh, modular, I don't know about that. Like, why haven't we seen this? Because I'm pretty sure everybody that makes music on Earth knows what modular is at this point. Why is, and it's not like I want to rush it, but I want to understand what's taking so long for it to catch on.
It's not appealing when you look at it, quite frankly. I think there's some apprehension and because it looks intimidating. You know what I mean? And what's becoming less of an issue that always has been a bit of an issue is the cost of entry. You know what I mean? Like these modules tend to be expensive. Even getting started with the not fun stuff, power and a case to put modules in tends to be expensive. You can get that and before long you've spent $600-$700 and you don't even have anything to make sound with yet. You know what I mean? You're just now ready to get some stuff. And even then you still have to put a couple more $100 in, right? But just now it's starting to become less of an issue because you have companies that are starting to make smaller and less expensive and cost friendly, size HP friendly modules that kind of take away that barrier, the cost of entry barrier. So I think cost has always been an issue. Intimidation has always been an issue. And, you know, I've literally had cats that are well known be like, yo, why you be using that stuff? What's it doing for you?
For real.
Like, what's it really doing for you? Like, I could think of much less complicated ways. I don't want no complications. You know what I'm saying? And you know, so I think there's a couple of things. I think the intimidation factor is huge when it comes to cats that make hip hop when they look at Eurorack. And maybe not the intimidation factor so much as the context that it's been used in so often is not appealing to what we make in hip hop.
Yeah.
The bleeps and the blops and the noise is not appealing to what we all approach things from, a rhythmic and melodic, like we all being in hip hop, the people that make urban music, I should say, because that encompasses like R&B or whatever it might be, neo soul and hip hop, boom bap, trap, all that. We approach things from a very melodic or rhythmic place, right? And when you think of Eurorack, or when you get exposed to Eurorack, all too often, it's bleeps, it's blops, it's noises, it's experimental, and it's too far for people most times to even comprehend that this could be musical. Do you know what I mean? Mm. Like, when I even first approached Eurorack, I knew that I was going to approach it from a musical perspective and make music with it and incorporated into the music that I was already doing. So I think there becomes a barrier there where it's not perceived as a musical thing.
Mm.
And even if you can get past that, then you have the cost of entry barrier. You know what I mean? So
yeah.
I just think there's a few things. Those are the more common things that I've kind of heard from folks. There's this one girl that wanted me to give her lessons. Mm-hmm. And she was like, but yo, it looked like you're dealing with a fire hazard over there. But then when I hear it, it's all beautiful. But when I look at all of the wires, I'm like, yo, are you messing up your light bill? Are you going to burn something up? Or what are you going to do? Oh, you know what I'm saying? So I think those are the kind of the reasons why people may kind of be hesitant to jumpstart into Eurorack. But that's just surface stuff.
Yeah. Yeah, I think... I don't know what I think it's coming along. You know, I remember like before it was like, nope, never, nope. And now people are like, okay. And there's more instruments on the market. That's right. That do make it a little bit more understandable and affordable. Mm-hmm. It's almost like because there's no guaranteed reward of result.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Like if you get a sampler, you can now sample, you can now do a number of things that are gratifying, like right now,
you know,
with modular, you got to do everything. And that doesn't mean anything. It doesn't mean you're going to get anything hot, you know?
Right.
So I don't know if I would spend my money on that either.
Mm-hmm.
And it took me a while. Like I've watched, all of you are responsible for my entry into it, but I sat on the sidelines just watching, and my first response was, first of all, it's a synth. That's my first thing was synths. I don't deal with synths. I deal with samplers, so forget that. You know? Right, and then I was right. Like, okay, well, I'm still watching. And then like a little bit of samplers. I remember probably the first thing I knew of was the Phonogene. I was like, yeah, well, whatever. I know, you know? And then I started just thinking outside of the box on what would you really do if this came to you? And like, could this really bring something new to what you're doing? And the answer is yes. And then it's like, well, do you have to play it like a synth? No. You know, well, what else can you do? And then you start seeing the options. But I agree in that, like, it's not, yeah, I never thought about that though, but it doesn't seem appealing. It's like, this doesn't do anything. You're right. Like what that, you mentioned someone said, well, what's this doing for you?
It's it's kind of like, yo, that's crazy, man. Why are you doing that?
Yeah. And the thing is, can you answer though? Like, I don't know. Like, I never know what this thing's going to do for me, but it does something hot, but I can't tell you what.
Well, you know, from my perspective, it's always just a matter of it takes me elsewhere in my creativity. Like, that's the thing. Yeah. I know that I'm going somewhere else when I deal with this. I know that the amount of flexibility that you have.
Yeah.
Like, so I got to a point where I have this, and I've shown it enough on Instagram, where I have this huge Eurorack case.
Yeah.
I think it's 18U, and I'm too lazy to count it right now, but I think it's 18U.
Yeah.
And you know, that was a big thing for me to get that case made, because this thing grew out of control. And I said, you know what? I do need a case. Let me get this done. I'm going to put this case together. So then right now, as I'm looking at the case, I have a roll with all drum modules. I have a roll with all effects modules. I have a roll with not even mostly. I'm looking at it. It's all oscillators. And then a row above that, I have, like, you know, a couple of modulation sources, but mostly filters. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Then I have another row with just other stuff. Maybe there's a contour thing. There's some random stuff up there. I have my clock joint. So I have these rows sort of dedicated to all this stuff. Mm-hmm. And what I know is if I send CV to my oscillator, and all I'm doing is just kind of playing it like a synth on the keys, whatever, on the pads. Okay, that's one thing. At that point, you could probably say to the person that asks, what do you do this for? Why do you use it? What's it do for you? You could probably say, well, at this point, it's no different than just a synthesizer, right? Mm. I'm literally playing the keys, the oscillator is hooked up, and I'm hearing the sound of the oscillator. However, the idea that you can then say, I want something more happening with that, and you can throw that into a filter, add modulation to the filter, so then now it's like you have a friend tweaking the cutoff. Mm-hmm. But it's the LFO, right? And then the idea that you can throw that into, like, I can throw that into the chain of effects that I have on the bottom row here, and I can do something that, you know, maybe record MIDI notes or CV notes onto the force. And now I have this line of stuff playing. And while it's playing that, say, melody, I can go in and start patching more and turn it into something even further than I could have even thought about.
Mm-hmm.
Like, the road is long on the creativity side.
It's crazy. And that's hard to explain. It's difficult to explain to someone who's not even trying to hear what you're saying, in the sense that
right. The
juice ain't worth the squeeze. You're telling me to go get a rack and all this stuff to do that? No. But there is...
It's not like you just spend a lot of money to cause yourself some trouble.
Yeah. And it's like, I'm now seeing kind of where it kind of comes from. But there is VC Reacts, and I'm pretty sure a lot of people just have Reactor Blocks full version just sitting there in their complete system, and they just don't touch it.
Yeah.
But that is the way, like, I have the free version of Blocks that you can't even patch, but you can, you know what I mean? You can make some stuff happen.
Yeah.
And that's pretty decent, you know?
It is. Like, you can get deep on some of that stuff.
Yeah.
And I'll tell you, me for one, I'm not for my own use, I'm not a super fan of some of the software patching systems, or Eurorack systems, or modular synth systems, just because I think for me there's something in, is it the cognitive sort of part of it, where you tell, your brain tells your hand touches a thing, it makes things happen. But the physical sort of approach of patching, the connection between brain and hand and then sound, is what I really like. So even though I can comprehend what's happening on the software versions of these things, it doesn't have the same, I don't make the same connection with it. And so it feels more tedious for me. But there's some people that are total opposite.
Mm-hmm.
But the thing is, if you want to explore stuff that gets you to a really creative place, you're right. Tons of people, how many units have sold of Native Instruments Complete.
And everyone has every Blocks. Year. Everyone.
Everybody has it.
Yeah.
You could dig into that and you already have it. Start to learn, like, that signal flow, the idea of patching one thing to another, and why something may not do something and the other thing may do something else. You can avoid that whole cost barrier.
Yeah, it's a good research ground. Like when you figure out where you want to go, especially now, like I almost feel sorry in the same breath of anyone starting now, just because the sheer amount of modules that are out here. I'm like, holy, the research you're going to have to do just to get your first module. It's not like it was before, you know, before there was like, there were some big heavy hitters. Like, yeah, you could, I wouldn't buy Mass right now. I may go for the Felistri I may do that instead, you know? So there's a whole bunch of options where before there were some like, your go-tos, you know, but now it's like a lot of research. It's really customized. You could get things are almost just the way you like it, depending on how the manufacturer thinks, you know?
Yeah. And you know what I'm finding, and I'll tell you too, I haven't mentioned this in public, but I'll mention it here. I'm actually designing a line of modules myself.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah. And I'm in development right now. And the reason I mention it is because it's relevant to the conversation. Things have advanced, and there's so many things that that used to be, you must have this in order to start. But there's so many things too that what me and the crew find and are patching, there's certain things that we patch up that we need that if you don't do hip hop, it's nothing that you, those things you don't need. If you don't do like urban music, like I said, that whole group of urban music, R&B, neo soul, hip hop, boom bap, trap, all that. If you're not doing urban music, there's some things that you have to go and kind of jerry rig together and patch in order to get a certain, in order to use a certain technique and start to build from that sort of urban music perspective. You know what I mean? And so I decided that I was going to make a few things. I'm going to make things that kind of bring that perspective where if I'm using two or three modules to do one thing, why? If you look at any of these modules, a lot of times you'd be like, yo, why does this complex oscillator also have like a secondary oscillator? Maybe sometimes it has a third oscillator that's really a LFO and it's built in. And then it has, you know, a low pass gate in there. And, you know, those are separate. Those can all be separate modules, but it was put into this complex oscillator for a reason. And so I'm using that same perspective from why do I have to patch up three or four modules just to do this simple thing that I need to do hip hop?
It's a lot
So now I'm designing modules that cater to, and not that it'll only be for people that do urban music, but it caters to certain techniques that are outside of your rack or maybe not as easily arrived at, right? And so that, but that's the growth, not only of growth in modular, but growth in Modbap and the idea that this stuff is real and the need is there.
Yeah.
And I think, you know, these things are going to kind of inform what new people start to do, new people or people that want to get into this start to do. And I'll maybe make it simplify some things a little bit where it's like, yeah, this makes sense from my hip hop production bag of tricks.
Yeah.
Why this thing does this like this. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But then it may open up somebody that maybe does techno or ambient and be like, yo, this makes this easy to be able to do this. Or yo, that adds a little flavor in my style of music to be able to use this thing.
Yeah.
So yeah, man.
Congrats first of all. Like that's great. You just made me get me into your rack you're dealing with.
Yeah.
You may get me into your rack because of that. But yeah, I think, yeah, like now that you've mentioned it, like most traditional synths kind of lend themselves towards the Tangerine Dream type thing, you know, and it's been that way for years and you've had to almost bring whatever genre you're coming in into that framework. And that's expanding now, but to hear modules being made with Modbap in mind. That's insane.
and you know, it's some of the and I've talked about this a little bit with like say Shiro. And I'll be like, yo, Shiro, does this make sense? I'm thinking about doing something like this and add that. And at some point I'll really be able to talk about what these things are. And obviously I'm not bankrolled like some of these companies are where I can't necessarily come out with a full line, but there'll be a couple to start and then it'll trickle in a couple more, you know, within a couple years, we should have a pretty decent line of stuff. But the stuff that I'm designing right now, I'll like hit up Shiro and be like, yo, does this make sense? I'm thinking about doing this. He's like, man, that would make my life so much easier. Like, you know what I'm saying? There's just stuff like that. And for the conversations that we may have with one another offline, like me and say me and Ken and D Still, it would be like something like simple as gate delays. This gate delay is out there, but why are there so many devices, samplers and stuff and sequences and all these different things that just don't have basic stuff that we need in hip hop? Yeah. Or that we need in time-based music, or, you know, that's a whole nother conversation. So the idea of what I'm doing is taking into consideration the things that we need that's kind of innate to us. You too. Like, I know that there's stuff that you do on those classic drum machines and samplers that's just a part of how you work. Mm-hmm. But you ain't going to find those bits and pieces in your rack. No. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Or you can, but you're going to have some conversations and do some research to figure out some clever patch.
Yeah, I have to build stuff. I have to build it with what I have. And that's why I'm saying that whole thinking. I'm thinking about, like, how do I get this to do this? And I could do it, and it helps with the learning process. But I'm just like, I'm MacGyvering everything, you know?
Yeah, exactly. And if you think about that, then that... So to bring things to a musical space when we're working with modular synthesis, the level of patching sometimes that you have to do just to kind of get to a place where now I can work this out.
Yeah.
You know, and it's like next level sometimes.
Yeah.
And that's what sometimes I've had people watch some live streams of me performing. And then come to the crib like, yo, I got questions. I need to know how you did that. What'd you do?
It's crazy.
Yeah.
Yeah, man. I'd rather, if I'm going to MacGyver something, I don't want to spend that much time doing simple things that I would expect or I would like to be in a smaller package.
Yep.
So I like that package, so I could now put my creative resources to doing something that is really, really out there. You know what I mean?
Yeah, exactly.
You know, so it's not like it's becoming easier for me. It's giving me room. I mean, it all goes back to that complacency in hip hop. It's like stopping at chopping is crazy. You know what I mean? Yeah. Like, there's so many forms of sampling that you can do, but because chopping is all it is, like, I want something to be in one spot for me, so I can do what I need to do easily, and then that gives me room to do something else. You know,
that's right, exactly. There's a I think that's the push and pull of this whole thing.
Yeah,
you know what I mean. Like that's the stuff. It feels like that's a recurring theme, even in our conversation about how to quantify this thing. Like the first question being, what is Modbap, and now let's quantify how you get there.
Mm.
And, right, but the idea is this push and pull. I need a certain set of tools and a certain foundation, a certain set of skill, a certain skill set, a certain foundational sort of skill set. Mm-hmm. But then I need room to explore and be expansive. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? And I think that's really where you really get on the runway for real. And you start really flying. You know what I mean?
Yeah. I'm really like, when people ask me, how come I use these old samplers? Because we're not done with them yet. Like, if I'm here learning every day new things about with samplers that were, I mean, the oldest sampler I have is nearing 40 years old, right? And I'm still finding things out. So I can't just jump ahead to the new technology because I'm literally like 20 years behind learning stuff. Abandon stuff that I haven't fully tapped out yet. And granted, I may never tap them out, but I'm never going to stop. You know what I mean? I'll take everything, but I'm not going to let go of something to jump to something else. So, you know, with modular, it really encourages that. It's like, you're never done. There is no done.
It's like, there's no destination. There's only the journey.
Yeah. Yeah. That's the great thing about it. It's like, you can never be like, yeah, I know modular. Like, what? You mean till next month? You know what I mean? Like,
even when you're sitting there with the thing that you think you know, then you stumble upon something or you meet somebody that has the same thing and they're like, yo, I do it like this. And you're like, what?
Exactly.
With that? You know what I'm saying? And then too, what I think is, I think that's like a common thought, but it's only because we're talking about something like modular synthesis. If people stop and thought, like when, what you're talking about with the sampler, well, I'm not done with them still learning things about it. And you know what I'm saying? That kind of, it's not just exclusive to this conversation. Like I'll go back and I'll think about my uncle, for instance. Mm-hmm. He plays a trumpet. The dude is incredible. It's been a big inspiration. Like, yo, he can take that piece of metal mm-hmm. and change people's mood. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Because he has the technique. And how many more new things are you going to do with a trumpet? You know what I mean? But when I came out to L.A. from Chicago and I formed a band, I had a band in Chicago. And, you know, we kind of a la the Roots, right? Mm-hmm. And so I came out here, I put together a band. And at one point, I had a horn section. Didn't plan on having a horn section, but this is L.A. And everybody does something and everybody knows somebody. So one day my bass player brought a saxophone player to the practice, and then the saxophone player had a trombone and trumpet dude that he brought to another practice. And before long, we had a horn session that played a couple shows with us. But what I thought was dope about this saxophone player, and I liken that to like my uncle playing a trumpet, right? He's playing a traditional instrument. But this saxophone player had a pedal board, like a guitarist. Mm. And it was all of this wild, these wild pedals there. And when he would play, we used to bug out. We'd be like, yo, and it started inspiring new songs or new like sections, or like we would totally rearrange songs that we had been playing based on incorporating what he was doing with his two horn homeboys and this damn pedal board of effects. So, you know, the idea that you can, like, this conversation isn't exclusive to, like, samplers and Eurorack.
Yeah.
It's the way we've kind of been thinking about a lot of different things. Mm-hmm. You can have, you know, drummers forever been playing the drums, but, you know, maybe a drummer might start to incorporate different ways of recording his drums or how he mics his drums. A bass player may play the bass, and you know that as a bass, but bass players get to start talking. They talk about the bass heads and the amps and different stuff that they're using. Like, I think that's important to keep up front with what we do too, right? It's mm-hmm. it's like I could have something that has been around, but I could dig in with different techniques and even learn more stuff about it or start incorporating other things and take things to a different place. It's not a new conversation. It's just that it feels foreign in the idea of doing hip hop and using instruments that we get so locked into.
Yeah. It's like we're seeing the music get old before our eyes.
Mm-hmm.
And I never thought it would get to this point, you know, but
of course, right?
It's old now, you know, it's really old, you know, it's old enough for it to start repeating itself and for it to have a revival. And that's mm-hmm. what we're seeing now. It's like, you know, we've seen a revival in everything else. We've seen grunge pop up out of nowhere and punk pop out of rock. Rock was already old, you know?
Yeah.
And now we're seeing something new. And that's why I really don't, you know, I don't hate on trap at all. Like, I genuinely like trap.
Mm-hmm.
But when these sort of revivals come, I'm never one to kind of be like, okay, that's not good or that's not this. You know, it's something new that's going to go somewhere. You know, and that's what we're experiencing now with Modbap. Like, this is going to, this, it's already going somewhere, but it's such a revival and such a, it's weird because it mm-hmm. does tie everything together. And that's kind of what hip hop didn't do. Like, Run DMC right. can't come out right now. UTFO can't come out right now rapping like how they were.
Mm-hmm.
I never really liked that. You remember when Run DMC tried to change their flow a little bit, and it's like, no, dude, man, like, keep it the way you guys were. Like, that was cool, you know?
Jesus, you are so on point with that. There's something that's like, yo, I don't care if people think that's old. That's who you are. You do that.
Yeah. Yeah, and it's like, that's the thing. It's sort of the great thing about hip-hop, but it's you know, when people say, well, how come, you know, older people, you know, kids still like classic rock? It's because of that. Mm-hmm. You know, classic rock is classic rock, and you don't have to, it's not an age thing, but hip hop is an age thing. And even everyone felt that way.
Yeah.
You know, there is an expiry date in the mind for mm-hmm. how, when you could start emceeing or producing or what you have to sound like right now. But what I see happening now is it's like a bridging of everything, you know, and that's going to mean a lot for the generation coming forward and the way they look at things.
Yeah.
You know, because yeah, the 90s did a lot for setting up a lot of rules, and not by like not intentionally, but where we are now in this huge divide we have amongst young kids, even lo-fi, yeah, and
the way you exactly, it's like ground zero. The 90s is ground zero for like where things got to it, things were epitomized.
Yeah. Yeah, like now it's like people are talking about a difference in lo-fi and boom bap. I'm like, if you don't see that that's the exact same thing, I can't help
it. Oh my God, this conversation is so on point. You know? Because I've had this conversation with D Still and Shiro and all that kind of stuff, and Ken. Like that is the straight up is like, oh, for myself, I always be thinking like, oh, well, if they calling it lo-fi, but that's just regular old boom bap hip hop. Like, I mean, but yeah, if it served to as a resurgence, then I'm cool with that, I guess. I mean, I ain't tripping when it comes, but it's weird how you see that kind of stuff. But you know what? What's interesting about it too, man, is when you think about, say, something like Modbap that kind of takes things and expands and pushes the envelope, mm-hmm, and kind of gets people to a creative space without losing the foundation, right? The other thing about it, when we talk about ageism and we talk about classic hip hop and classic rock and all those kind of things, mm-hmm, I think it's high time for us to really consider like, yo, that's classic hip hop. And, you know, I remember when I was younger and I was studying for my degree in electronics, mm-hmm, and we were building circuits, and this dude was a little older than us. He was probably my age now. He was my age then. Mm-hmm. And I was maybe half his age, mm-hmm, and or something like that. Maybe he wasn't even that old, but shoot, back in the day, if somebody's 5 years older, you're like, yo, you are like old. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Right. But anyway, we were listening to A Tribe Called Quest, and he hadn't heard this stuff. And he was like, yo, that's interesting. That's different. I was like, yeah, man, it's almost like easy listening hip hop. And he's like, I ain't supposed to be like that. Mm-hmm. But I was like, but yo, it's almost like, you know, bebop and, you know what I'm saying, big band and free jazz and that kind of thing. When you go to classic rock, you got easy listening, and you got classic rock and metal and all that kind of stuff. I think it's high time that hip hop had that, because that to me kind of would erase that idea. It makes hip hop expansive from a genre perspective.
Yeah.
It erases the idea where this town ain't big enough for the two of us.
Exactly.
You know exactly what I'm saying? It gives everybody a space to exist. And so when you're 40 something and what you want is golden era hip hop, okay, that's really like classic hip hop, the way cats got to when they were career minded or, you know, family minded, and they were still into rock. That became classic rock. Mm-hmm. It don't look as crazy as like, it don't mean that you all of a sudden have to have long hair and smoking weed to listen to the music you grew up on. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? It puts it in a place. And I actually hope that Modbap kind of helps with that a little bit, to be able to say like, yeah, this is all hip hop. Yo, this is Modbap. And in reality, it's kind of expanding the culture.
It will. And,
you know what I mean?
It will. Like that's the whole problem with hip hop, is that we always had to jump on the new in order to stay fresh. Mm-hmm. I mean, the gift of hip hop is the curse of hip hop. Everything's supposed to be fly, fresh, and new. But when you start looking at a 40, 50 year old period, you physically age. So mm-hmm, you got to kind of do what you do best with the era you came from. But when we always start to jump on the new thing and the new thing and the new thing, the old always gets forgotten. Mm-hmm. You know, you notice like most of the children out right now, they don't know anything past Dilla. And yeah, if they know anything about Biggie, that's like a big thing, Biggie and Tupac. I mean, like, to me, that was like just now. That was like yesterday.
That's, you know, right. I'm like, the way you said it, that was just now. Yeah. Like, weren't we just there?
Yeah. But that's like ancient history to them. I'm like, do you know how much is before that you guys don't know about and don't want to know about? And I can't blame you, because it's not your fault. Like, we do that to the genre, you know? And
yeah,
with this, it's like it's made me bring turntables back into what I'm doing. It's made me kind of just like put everything in the same pot again, not like just be like, this is this and this belongs here. I'm not doing that no more. And it's helped. Yeah. So I'm expecting the genre to do that just because of the way modular behaves. Mm-hmm. You kind of want to throw everything into it.
Yeah, exactly. Because you think of, you got samplers and stuff, but they behave differently than traditional samplers. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, that's why at first I couldn't even understand. I'm like, why do I want a sampler in Eurorack? I got a sampler that I'm using with Eurorack. You know what I mean? But then I found myself with Morphogene and I'm like, oh, that's a little different. And actually, I kind of like it. But once I got warmed up to it, I'm like, actually, I kind of like the way this sampler works. To enhance what my regular sampler and stuff is doing. And so, you know, you start crossing those boundaries, and it's cool to, you know, I looked up, I saw Ken one day making Modbap and start cutting on his turntables. You know what I'm saying? Like, I love that kind of thing, that idea of that. I got a homeboy to hit me up, and, you know, he was like, so what, you just retiring your Emcee skill? We ain't gonna get a verse like never no more? And I'm like, well, I don't even think about it, really. It ain't like I made a conscious decision. But then I hit him with a Modbap instrumental, and he put a song to it. He put two verses to it and a hook. And I was like, yo, that's freaking amazing. So I feel like even that is kind of the next frontier, too, with, you know, getting MCs involved in an act. And because when I heard dude spit on these beats, I was just like, this is crazy. It's absolutely nuts.
We haven't even heard that yet.
It feels like the next thing. You know what I mean? It feels like that, something new, but still familiar. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, it's going to be nuts, man. For, okay. So for anybody getting into this, because what should they do? They've heard this conversation we've had. They want to get into modular. What do they do? How do they start?
I think there's a few different ways to start. I think they're fortunate that there's people making cost effective and size effective. Like, there's value in smaller HP, and also those things tend to be more cost effective. So if you want to go the more traditional hands-on route and actually doing Eurorack, you can do a couple things. You can either do semi-modular to get you kind of to a point where you're understanding the signal flow and understanding what somebody means when they say, you know, an LFO, or when they say whatever it might be. You know, you can get a Mother 32, or what's the other joint that Behringer did? I mean, there's so many things out there now. Yeah, the Neutron, Model D, Mother 32, Ocos, those semi-modular things, the Arturia Mini Brute 2, 2SE or whatever it is. You can get any of those semi-modular things and start to understand the signal flow. And those will be easier to incorporate into your beat making if you already have, say, a machine, or you have MPC, or anything, any of the older synths. You'll be able, because it's hardware, you'll be able to incorporate that stuff pretty simply. MIDI or patching or USB connectivity for like machine and MPC software. But if you're in the world of DAW, the DAW world, and you maybe are in machine software, you maybe are in the MPC software, or maybe you're in Ableton and you're in Logic or something. You can incorporate the software modular stuff. What is it? Native Instruments Blocks.
Blocks, yeah.
You can incorporate VCV Rack. You can go get Arturia's Modular V, which is a Moog modular, virtual Moog modular sort of emulation. All those things you could do on a software side before you even get to the physical side. And 9 times out of 10, you probably have all of that stuff. Maybe not VCV Rack, but VCV Rack is free, just FYI.
Yeah.
You can get VCV Rack and incorporate that. But chances are, if you are a plug-in sort of guy, you probably have Blocks already with your Native Instruments Complete.
Yeah.
If you are the kind that's like, yo, I love Arturia stuff and I bought the V collection, you already have Modular V in there. Open them joints up, start patching, see what it does, see what these different things mean to patch something to another. So that's two routes. Either if you're going software, you can go that route, or if you're going hardware, you can go semi-modular route. Then that way you're dipping your toe in, you're dipping your feet in the pool. But you know how it is, you sit on the edge of the pool, you put your feet in the pool, you could do that for hours. But the moment you go further than your abdomen, you're like, So you could just go semi-modular, just dip your feet in the pool and see how that works out. But then if you find that you like it, or you find that, you know, yo, I'm not getting enough modulation, or I'm not getting deep enough into it with just semi-modular, that probably is the point where you want to start looking for modules that sort of speak to what you want to do. And like I said, the cost of entry is getting shorter. You got cases out there by IntelliGel, a 62, Pallet 62. I don't know, I think it's like $200, whereas before you couldn't get a case for less than $400.
Wow.
Stuff like that. So now you have like Make Noise One, the Skiff, that's like $200, or the Pallet 62 is like $200 or $299, whatever it might be, with power.
Mm-hmm.
And you could throw smaller modules by, say, 2HP or Erica Sense Pico line. Different stuff like that. I know After Ladder coming out with a line of modules that are cost conscious. I know that Polyend, I think it's Polyend.
Yeah, who maybe make the sequencer?
Yeah, they make the sequencer, but they have, is it them or the people they collab with to make the Medusa? At any rate, they have a line of inexpensive modules that are coming out. That you could put together a system for a few $100s as opposed to a few $1,000s.
Oh, wow.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
There's many ways to dig in, but like I said, I think if you're coming from a hardware perspective, maybe start with something semi-modular, and you could get there. If you're coming from a software perspective, maybe start with some software like Blocks, or the things that I've named, VCV Rack and stuff like that. There's ways to get in. But what's going to happen is the more you explore, the more rewarding things are, the more curious you get. And that's when people start talking about the rabbit hole. So don't be afraid of the rabbit hole, but just know you don't want to just go out there willy-nilly and start spending money on stuff that you don't know and don't understand. So at least kind of play around with other stuff that may not cost, have big, you know what I'm saying? I just can't see, I've seen people buy upwards of more than $1,000 worth of Eurorack stuff and realize that's not what they wanted to do. Oh, they don't, wow. They don't like it. It's too tedious or whatever. They don't like it. And so they sell everything off. I don't want to see people go down that road. But there's ways to dip in, like the things that I just named.
That is, yeah, I think that's, I tend to agree. 100%. Unless you know that that's what you want to dive into. I think going in slowly is the only way to remain sane. It's easy to get overwhelmed, but yeah, I think, yeah, very, very well said.
Yeah, no doubt, man.
Yeah, man. And with that, I think that is a good place to end it. It's, man, I always love talking to you, man. It's like I could talk to you forever.
No doubt, man. Our conversations can go. I same here, man, without a doubt. It's a good conversation all the time.
Yeah, man. I think we'll close it off there. I think I'll leave the links for well, let's say this. As yourself for your resource, where can we find information about you?
Oh, yeah. So a couple places. You know, I still run Beat People, bboytechreport.com. So that's BBOYTECH report, REPORT.com. That's kind of like the place where music tech meets hip hop, right? Like I resurrected that thing for people to get music tech news, reviews, and interviews, but from a hip hop perspective. It's our voice in music tech news. So bboytechreport.com is where you can find that. And then you can find me just about on any social media platform at bboytechreport. You know, to end on that, then there's Beat People, BEATPPL, right? And that's where I sell sample packs and you know, music, if you want to hear music that I've done, that's kind of like my label for sound design and music. And I also sell t-shirts and stuff out there, but pretty much the foundation of it is B-Boy Tech Report. You can find me with that anywhere.
Nice. And I'll put links in the video below to everything, man. Corry, thanks so much, man. I really, really appreciate this conversation. I think it's great. It's a great way to go over the genre and what's needed and where it comes from, also in hip hop as well. So thank you so much for sharing your time, man.
No, I appreciate you, man. Thanks for having me. I really appreciate one, your enthusiasm, your interest, the incredible work that you do online, yo, the visuals, the just the calm, technically competent knowledge so much, that you drop on people. And so, yeah, I appreciate you too, bro. And the conversations are always good. Thanks for having me.
Word up. Thank you.